The following Stealing the Mind Bible Conference presentation is by Frank Peretti and Northern Cross and is entitled The Covering. For a free catalog of all of our tapes and books, call Compass at 1-800-977-2177 or on the web at compass.org.
I just want to look at you because Jesus wants to talk to you. He wants to talk to me. He wants to talk to you. We're toward the end of the day now, and I just want to have a precious time together. I want to talk about Jesus' grace, how he's got you covered. I was going through a bit of a struggle and kind of, had you ever feel like, man, I am such a foul up, and I'm such a dope, and I'm so dumb, and I, you know, you just, you know how Satan is the accuser of the brethren? And now every little thing you ever did wrong in your life, you did that wrong. I don't know, I was going through those, you know, the poopies. Someone in church brought me a little card. All it said was, my grace is sufficient for Frank. What is it about the Lord? He knows just how to get his little helpers out there to give you what you need at the right time. I think a lot about Brother Paul. Paul the Apostle. Now, a lot is said about Paul's thorn. How many have ever heard of Paul's thorn? The thorn in the side. Oh, what was it? Was it his eyesight, or maybe he was sick, or maybe he was weak, or maybe it was persecutions? I have my own little view on that. Coming from where I'm coming from, or where you're coming from, what I just wanted to talk about was, you know, we hear it all the time, don't we? You're saved. You're forgiven. Your sins are removed from you as far as the east is from the west. And you just want to keep, yeah, right, I'm forgiven. But I don't know how many of you go through the same thing I go through every once in a while, and that is regret. Regret. You know you're forgiven. And you say, yes, I'm forgiven. But still, being human, there are just those times when you think, man, if I'd only, oh, if I wouldn't have, oh, I wish I didn't. Oh, think about Paul. That's what I think Paul's little thorn was. He says here in 2 Corinthians 12:7, he just got through talking about these wonderful revelations from the Lord and all this stuff. And then he says, and lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, to keep me from getting too big a head about this, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure. I know how Satan likes to buffet us more than anything. Oh, he can attack us. I wrote this Present Darkness, and one of the questions I got so much of the time after I wrote that was, did you go through any spiritual attack when you wrote that book? And I'd love to be able to tell them, yes, I did. I was alone one night in my study. I heard a rattling of the windows, and I looked behind me, and I'll tell you the kind of spiritual attack I went through. It's just kind of the thing I'm talking about. Satan, he knows where to get you, where you hurt the most. He knows where you're delicate. He knows where you're tender. He knows where you're hurting. He knows the people you've disappointed. He knows the really dumb things you've done all your life. You fill in the blank. And then he comes along and says, hey, remember that? Concerning this thing, this is Paul again, concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities that the power of Christ may rest upon me. The Lord is saying, Paul, I know you're a foul up. I know you're a loser. Don't worry, I got you covered. There's a funny thing about covering. I started looking about this through the Bible and everything, and I was just wondering, oh, man, can you imagine what Paul must have gone through? I can identify with Paul. Imagine what he must have gone through. That dispute he had with Barnabas over Mark. No, Mark is not coming with us. He abandoned us. He is not coming. And Barnabas went his way and Paul went his way. Boy, we're going. I'm going to go out and spread the gospel without him. Show people what a wonderful, loving God we have. And Paul probably thought after that, oh, man, I can't believe what I said to Barnabas. He's never going to speak to me again. And, of course, Satan said, you blew it, didn't you? At one time, Paul was preaching all night. He preached so long, a young man fell asleep in the window and fell out of the window and got killed in the street below. Now, that's one way to really put a damper on a service. Well, Paul ran down there and laid hands on him, and his breath is still in him. I can imagine Paul by himself in his motel room after that, you know. I can't believe I preached all night. I should have looked at my watch. I can't believe what I did. I can't believe I said that to everybody. No wonder they wanted to stone me. Oh, that was a bad sermon. That was just so bad. Imagine all the... Oh, you just had to say that, didn't you? You knew it was going to hurt their feelings, but you had to shoot your mouth off. And what about this one? Stephen, I am so sorry. I'm so sorry, Stephen. They were stoning you to death, and I held the coats of those who killed you. I wonder if Paul ever was preaching and maybe had that little hidden fear that somewhere someone's going to come up in the back of the audience, maybe wave their hanky at him, you know. Look at these scars on my back. That's because you drug me into prison and turned me over to the tormentors and they whipped me. Preach it, brother. You can say it's all in the past. It's forgiven. And yet, on another level, another part of your mind, you never forget it. He called himself the least of the apostles. I don't even deserve to be called an apostle, he said. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, 12 through 16, he says, I was a blasphemer. I was a persecutor. I was a violent aggressor. I was an insolent man. Well, what better way to keep a guy humble? Just imagine how he felt. Are you with me? This weird dilemma. You know you're forgiven, but shame and regret keep hounding you. I just want to share something with you. God's got you covered. He's got you covered. I was thinking about covering, and I began to think, you know, all through the Bible, there's this whole idea of covering, covering, covering. The very first covering, you remember what that was. That was after Adam and Eve sinned, you know, the forbidden fruit and all that stuff. What happened? Right off the bat, they knew they were naked. Now, that is pretty strange. How many years had they walked around without a stitch on and we're not naked? I mean, it's like this. You've heard the expression, I just feel naked in front of you. I mean, you just feel so embarrassed, so ashamed. You feel like, I don't have any secrets at all. Poor old Adam, he used to be 6'1". When God walked through the garden calling him, he was 4'7". Adam, where are you? Well, I heard your voice in the garden and I hid myself because I was naked. I think it's the shame. I think it's the sin. It's not a matter of whether or not you're wearing clothes. It's a matter of just being really wide open before God who can see everything. What's the first thing that happened? God had to slay an animal, probably the first sacrifice. He made clothing of skin and he clothed them. Guess what? Keep that in mind. God made the clothing. He put it on them. Now that is a pattern that goes through the whole Bible. You know about the Ark of the Covenant. Boom, 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 boom. And it was in the tabernacle in the wilderness. And it was in the temple. And inside the Ark was the Ten Commandments. And then on top of the Ark was the lid. And the lid was called the mercy seat. Why? Because once a year, the priest would go in there and he would sprinkle the blood of a sacrificial lamb on the top of that lid. And here's the point. God would look down from heaven upon that ark. He would look down. He'd look right through that lid. He'd see the Ten Commandments, and he would know, my people have transgressed my commandments. But you put that blood on the lid. The first thing God sees is the blood, and he knows that sin has been paid for. It's covered. Here's another one. Saints in Revelation. Now we're clear to the other end. You see, in many different chapters, the saints of God in Revelation, consistently they are robed in garments of white. White robes, those are symbolic of righteousness of God that the Lord gave to them. Here's another one, Matthew 22:11. Jesus told a story about the king who gave a big wedding feast for his son, and he invited all of his guests, and all of his guests said, "Oh, we're too busy to come." And they laughed, and they scorned, and they beat the servants, and they didn't come. And so the king said, "Well, go out into the highways and the hedges and find all the lost and the poor and the crippled and all the outcasts of society and bring them into my wedding feast." They all came in, and then it says right toward the end of that parable, a man came into that wedding feast without a wedding garment. You need to understand some of the customs of that day. When a king gave a big wedding feast, he supplied the wedding garments. You show up there and get all fitted, and he gives you the wedding garment. You wear it into the wedding. In comes a guy without a wedding garment. He thought he could get in on his own righteousness. And the king said, "You're not dressed properly for this wedding." And out he went. But that's the covering again. Prodigal son. You know the story. The prodigal son. He says, "Oh, I want to get out of here. I want to live high on the hog. Give me my inheritance." Off he goes. You know the story. When he comes back, "Oh, father, I'm not fit. I'm not worthy to be called your son. Just make me one of your servants, one of your slaves." And the father said, "Bring out the best robe and put it on him." In the households of that day, the best robe was reserved for the guest of honor. Notice that they put the robe on him. He didn't put it on himself. Put a ring on his hand. The ring is a sign of authority. Put sandals on his feet. Slaves didn't usually wear sandals. The household wore sandals. This young man, through no credit, through no effort of his own, was brought back into the arms of his father, and his father clothed him in righteousness and dressed him like one of the home, one of the family. He's got you covered. He's got you covered. Here's a funny one. John 21, this is after Christ's crucifixion and his resurrection, and the disciples have gone back to fishing. And they're out there fishing, and they haven't caught anything. You know the story. And Peter says, the Bible says he was stripped for work. He's probably in his swimsuit or something, or his cutoffs. I don't know. What, you know, you figure it out. Anyway, but of course then, "Children, what? Have you caught any fish?" "Oh, we've been out here all night. We haven't caught a thing." "Well, cast your net on the other side of the boat." What's on this side of the boat? A lake. What's on this side of the boat? A lake. They threw it on the other side. You know the story. So many fish, the boat began to sink. And then someone says, "It's the Lord." Now, here's where it gets backwards. When you go swimming, usually you take your clothes off, you know, and you dive in. Peter's in the boat. He's got his clothes off. He puts his clothes on, and then he dives in. I know how Peter felt. He felt like Adam. He felt like all of us when we stand before the holy Lord God. We felt naked. We felt ashamed. He came up to the Lord and said, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man." It's interesting, he had denied the Lord three times, but it was right there that the Lord gave him three times to redeem himself. "Simon Peter, do you love me?" "Yes." "Do you love me?" "Yes." "Do you love me?" "Yes." "Feed my sheep." The Bible says love covers a multitude of sins. And Jesus, when he wept over Jerusalem, remember his words, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. There's that covering again. That biblical picture of the hen gathering her chicks under her wing. That's how Jesus likes to view things. Well, let me tell you a little story about Ruth. I love the picture that the scripture draws of Ruth. Now, you remember Ruth. This was back in the time of the judges. Israel was kind of in a mess back then. Well, there was a nice lady. Her name was Naomi. And she married a man named Elimelech. Now, that name means, my God is king. Well, Naomi married Elimelech, and they had two sons. One was named Malon, which means sick. And one was named Chilion, which means pining. So, and Naomi, of course, means, where is it? It'll come, oh, Pleasant. Okay, all right. So Pleasant married, my God is king, and they had sick and pining. Well, they had a depression, a famine in the land, and so Elimelech, he found out that there was work and there was food over in Moab. So he picked up the whole family, and they moved to Moab, stayed there for quite a while. Now, while they were there, sick and pining, found two women, and they married them. The one of the name woman was Pining. Her name's big enough. Pining married a lady named Orpah, and her name means stubborn. Now that goes together real well, pining and stubborn. Sick did a little better. He found a woman whose name was Friendship. Ruth, that's what Ruth means. Well, turned out that Elimelech died. Then, lo and behold, the two sons died too. So now here's Naomi and her daughter-in-laws, Orpah and Ruth. And Naomi is saying, the Lord has really dealt badly with me. I don't know what it is. I know we're the chosen people, but he ought to pick on somebody else. She says, I'm going to go back to my homeland, back to my hometown. There's nothing left for me here. And the daughters began to follow her. Oh, we'll go with you. Oh, no, no, you don't want to go with me. Whatever I got, you don't want to catch it. Orpah finally decided to go back, so she went back, and Naomi said, oh, Ruthie, you should go back too. You don't want to go with me. And you know that wonderful commitment that Ruth made? Don't entreat me to leave you or to return from following after you, for wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people shall be my people. And your God will be my God, and where you die, that's where I'll die. And there will I be buried. The Lord do so to me and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. That's real important to remember that Ruth was an outsider. She was a Moabite. She was a Gentile. She was not part of the chosen people. She was not a Jewess. And yet she said to Naomi, I will go where you go. I will live where you live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. And she returned to Bethlehem with Naomi. And Naomi came into town. Oh, it's Naomi. Welcome back. Oh, what are you calling me Naomi for? Don't call me Naomi because that means pleasant. Call me Mara because Mara means bitter. The Lord's treated me bitterly. Came back to a lot of debt, about to lose her property and lose all of whatever estate was left to Elimelech, Malon, and Chilion. It's tough being a woman in those days and being impoverished because you've got no man to take care of you and your estate. The head of the estate is gone. He's dead. What are you going to do? Well, Ruth took very good care of Naomi, and she went out to glean one day. Now, it's important to remember, when the poor would go out to glean, those who had land and wealth and had the barley growing there, the Bible says, the law said, when you harvest your field, when you come up to the corner of your field, you don't go right up square, and you don't harvest the whole thing right square. No, when you're threshing and harvesting your barley, you make a big corner like this, so that you leave this corner here for the poor to come and glean grain from your field. And if you're putting the sheaves on the back of your wagon and you drop one, you don't go back and get it. You leave it for the poor. That's what Ruth was doing. She was picking up the fallen sheaves, and she was gleaning the barley grain. And along came the owner of the land. His name was Boaz. And Boaz means, in him is strength. So here he comes. What I like about Boaz, he doesn't come to work and say, all right, guys, get to work. What's the matter, you slackers? Move it, move it, move it. No, he says, the Lord be with thee. And all the guys and all the workers say, the Lord bless thee. Had a real good relationship. And Boaz is saying, okay, how's it going? Whoa, hello. Who's the young lady over there? Oh, well, that's Ruth, the Moabitess. She's taking care of Naomi. She's a wonderful person. And, oh, yeah, to her, all this wonderful report about how Ruth had devoted herself to Naomi and made a commitment to the Lord God of Israel and all this wonderful stuff. So Boaz went to Ruth, and he said, oh, Ruth, listen, you just stay with my maidens, and they'll show you the ropes, and they'll help you glean. And if you need any water, there's water right there. And I've instructed all the young men to just stay away from you and don't bother you. They're all kind of, stay away. He gave her dinner that night, fed her really well, filled up her apron with all kinds of barley. She went home to Naomi and poured all the barley out. Oh, Ruthie, where did you go to work today? Oh, it was so wonderful. I went to this field, and this wonderful man came up, and he gave me all this wonderful barley, and he took care of me. He helped me. He gave his maidens to help me, and he told the guys to leave me alone. Well, who is he? Oh, somebody named Boaz. Oh, Ruthie. Ruthie. He's more than just a good man. He's a close relative. Ruthie, you listen to me carefully now. This is Naomi talking. You talk, you do what I tell you. See, Naomi knew that according to the law, if you're left and you're bereft and your husband is dead, the next of kin can marry you or marry your offspring or whatever. Anyway, he can buy your land and buy your house and buy all that stuff, pay off your debts and get you out of debt and redeem you. He can, are you ready? He can cover you. Ruthie, here's what you do. So, Ruthie went to her closet, and she got out her best dress, and she put on her best robe, and she put on her best shoes, and she... And put a robe on. And she went to the threshing floor that night where all the wheat, the barley had been threshed, and all the guys were sleeping near the barley harvest to protect it. And there they all are. And they're sleeping, and Ruthie comes in very quietly. And, you know, Naomi gave her these instructions that are a little strange, but, you know, Ruth, she's in a strange country, different customs. Okay, I'll do it. So she lies down at Boaz's feet, and she uncovers his feet. Here's Boaz, he's sleeping. He starts to have dreams, you know, about wading through really cold streams and things like that. Oh, boy, and he wakes up, and there's this woman lying at his feet. Who are you? He probably said, who are you? She was probably as scared as he was. Oh, sir, I'm Ruth. Remember, I gleaned in your field, and I'm the daughter-in-law of Naomi. Here comes the neat part. She says, Sir, would you please cover me? Take the corner of your garment and cast it over me. For you're my nearest kinsman. You're the only one who has the right to redeem me. Boaz was a just man and a loving man, and I can just see him looking at Ruth, an outsider, an outcast, a stranger in poverty. She and her mother-in-law alone. And I can just see Boaz taking off his robe. He lays it over her shoulders. And he says, "Don't worry, little Moabitess. I will cover you. I will cover you." Of course, the story goes on where Boaz arranged with the next of kin who was closer than him and made some arrangements with the elders that he would take Ruth as his wife. He would buy the estate of Naomi and redeem it out of debt and take care of Ruth and Naomi the rest of their days. And that's exactly what happened. And the Bible says that Ruth and Boaz had a little boy. And the little boy, they named him Obed. And Obed means serving. And he was always remembered as serving, son of sick. What happened was the folks said to Naomi, "Naomi, the Lord is good to you because he's redeemed you out of your poverty, and now someone will carry on your name and you'll be safe and you'll be covered." And it's so wonderful to think of, "Oh, hello there, Mara. What's this Mara stuff? The Lord God has dealt wonderfully with me. Oh, come here, Obed. Come to Grandma. The Bible says she just took care of little Obed, and her joy was restored, and her inheritance was restored, and the family name continued on." And, of course, you remember the story of how Obed grew up and had a son named Jesse, and Jesse grew up and had a son named David, who was the king of Israel and the forerunner of the Messiah, Jesus. And the lesson here, folks, is remember, he's got you covered. He's got you covered. And as Paul said, "I will rejoice in my weakness and my infirmities because God can do something beautiful with my weakness. In my weakness, he is made strong." You've got this little gal who is an outsider, a Moabitess, out of town, out of God's people. But the Lord brought her in. And did a beautiful thing, because out of this little stranger who made a decision to follow the Lord came the Messiah. Now, how many of you are just like Ruth? You're feeling outside of things. You're feeling like you're not quite right with God. Maybe even, there's two kinds of people here tonight. There are those who are saved and know the Lord Jesus, and there are those who don't. And maybe some of you are saying, "Well, God's fine for everybody else, but he can never accept me." The Lord God is like Boaz. He's just holding that robe, and he's ready to just throw it over your shoulders and say, "Don't worry about it. I've got you covered. My grace is sufficient in your weakness." A lot of us have the dumb things we did when we were a kid, or the people that we hurt, or the hurtful things we said or did. Some are suffering from post-abortion syndrome, failed marriages, the things you never said to a loved one who is now gone. You fill in the blank. There are those of you that Satan would love to remind of all the mistakes and the sins and the stumblings in your life. And even if you are saved and know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, and you've been taught and you have learned up one side and down the other, "I'm forgiven." Those memories still come back. I just want you to know, brother, sister, God's got it covered. He's got it covered, and in the Spirit, please look at your shoulder. You are wearing a robe of righteousness, and the Lord Jesus put it there. We're going to sing one more song for you. But while the band is coming, I think I'll just pray. Lord Jesus, I pray right now for everybody here, this wonderful family, all in various places in our lives, things we've come from, struggles we've had, disappointments, deep mistakes, sins, people we've hurt. Lord, right now, just like I'm thinking now of that gal that came in to see Jesus. She was a sinner. She was a prostitute. She came in and she just wept and she cleaned Jesus' feet with her tears, wiped his feet with her hair. She sat at Jesus' feet because that's where forgiveness was. And he accepted her. I think just like Boaz, he covered her. Brother, sister, put yourself in that place tonight. Let Jesus just look down on you and say, don't worry. I know all about it. I got you covered. Stick around for a while. Let's talk. Let's visit.
As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good away, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, sisters, let's go down, come on down. Oh, sisters, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the starry crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, brothers, let's go down, come on, brothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, fathers, let's go down,
don't you
come on down. Oh, fathers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. As I went down in the river to pray, studying about that good old way, and who shall wear the robe and crown, good Lord, show me the way. Oh, mothers, let's go down, come on down. Oh, mothers, let's go down, down in the river to pray. Oh, sinners, let's go down, let's go down, won't you come on down. Oh, sinners, let's go down, down in the river to pray.
Thank you very much. What a privilege it is to be here back in Anaheim. My gosh. Got a little bit of Ten Commandments for you here. Gospel. So our apologies to those of you who might be bluegrass purists. What we do, since we come from such varied backgrounds, is we took our music experience, brought it to the bluegrass instrumentation. So we come up with all kinds of really strange things, different styles, but with that bluegrass feel. We also take traditional songs, tear them apart, and put them back together again. And this is what happened to this one. Right? Paul and Silas bound in jail all night long. Paul and Silas bound in jail all night long. Paul and Silas bound in jail all night long, crying, "Who shall deliver me?" The jailer watched outside the door
all night long.
The jailer watched outside the door
all night long.
The jailer watched outside the door
all night long,
crying,
"Who shall deliver me?"
Well, Paul and Silas sang and prayed
all night long.
Paul and Silas sang and prayed
all night long.
Paul and Silas sang and prayed
all night long. All night long.
Crying,
who shall deliver me?
Well, that old jailhouse reeled and rocked
all night long.
All night, that old jailhouse reeled and rocked
all night long.
Yes, it did. That old jailhouse reeled and rocked
all night long.
Crying,
who shall deliver me?
The jailer wept on Silas' neck all night long. The jailer wept on Silas' neck all night. The jailer wept on Silas' neck all night long, crying,
who can
deliver
me?
Paul and Silas pounded,
Paul and Silas pounded jail all night long.
All night.
Paul and Silas bound in jail
all night
long.
All night.
Paul and Silas bound in jail all night long.
Uh-huh.
All night long.
Crying,
who shall deliver me?
That old jailhouse reeled and rocked.
That old jailhouse reeled and rocked
and rolled.
All night long. That old jailhouse reeled and rocked
and reeled.
All night long. That old jailhouse reeled and rocked. All night long,
crying,
who shall deliver me?
Yeah, they were crying.
Who shall deliver me?
Paul and Silas crying.
Who shall deliver me?
Thank you.
What's next here?
I think it's you, I think you're next, Mr. Brownlee.
I don't want to do that song.
Why?
Because it makes fun of me.
But you wrote it.
Well, I never thought we'd do the darn thing.
It's on the list, Mr. Brownlee.
It's on the list, and I wrote it because I got a problem with the Lord. Me and Lord got a problem. I you know that old prayer, give me patience and give me it right now. Well, I'm like, Lord, come on, you know, Domino's Pizza does better than this. And she tells me to stop and smell the roses, and I do, and then I wonder, who's going to fertilize them, and who's going to trim them, and who's going to kill the darn aphids? And I realized why men are like this. It's because we start out as spermatozoa, and we're in a race with a million other of them, and all we got is one floppy paddle to get there, you know, and it's hard. So I wrote this song about patience.
You heard what they say about men asking directions, you know, and it just goes to show a million of these guys and only one of them gets there, you know. That's just
I'm ready. Wait on the Lord is a double entendre.
He's making you wait a little longer.
We're waiting, Lord.
Okay, now it's right.
Right.
One, two, one, two, three, and.
I have a very bad habit when I'm advised to wait. I'm like a scared jackrabbit out of the starting gate, like a steam locomotive. I surely must confess, I gotta need to get a rolling. I'm like a man obsessed. I don't need a reservation. I can fabricate my own. I don't believe in hesitation. I skip, ready, set, and I just go. I gotta get with the program. I gotta get off the dime. I gotta head down the road, damn. Cause I'm making up for lost time. I pray for direction and I set my own course. I'm sure I'm correct and say, don't bother me, Lord. I'm doing your work just as fast as I can. I just get on a roll and then he raises his hand. I got a way,
huh?
You'd think as I get oldish, I'd start accumulating sense. But I just get more bullish. I'm graduating up to dance like a class 5 tornado, much to my chagrin. I can't feed my manly ego. If I'm not buried to my chin, I don't have one reservation about charging right in. I lead the stubborn delegation. My hands as thick as my hair is thin. I gotta get with the program. I gotta get off the dime. I gotta head down the road and start making up for lost time. Well, I get up with the chickens, but I don't get the worm. I work like the dickens, but I don't seem to learn. I can hit the floor early and hit the sack late, but I still can't do a thing to hurry up my own fate. I gotta wait. So be different. I'm gonna change my ways.
Yes, sir.
You know I'd ask for forgiveness, but I'm too busy to pray like a diesel 18-wheeler on a steep downhill grade, headed to meet up with the reaper. If I don't stand on the brakes, I need a heart re-education. If I can just give in and face the stark realization that I can't do it without him. I gotta get with his program, cause I've been spending his time. Get off my own time zone, man. Get on Jehovah meantime. Pray for direction, then I set my own course. I'm sure I'm correct and say, don't bother me, Lord. I'm doing your work just as hard as I can. I just get on a roll and then he holds out his hand. I gotta wait. Okay, Lord, I'm waiting.
Yeah. Real quickly, we're going to introduce the members of the group. First over here, our favorite member of the group, and probably yours too, just a great musician, and most of all, a great man, a great husband, and a wonderful father, a first grade teacher, and a good songwriter who wrote this next song, Mr. Terry Lutaker. And then over here on my left, in your, well, it'd be center, wouldn't it, is my best friend and my wife. And I love her and all that stuff. She's a teacher. Used to teach 5th through 12th grade. Now she teaches 18-month through 5th grade, so I guess she's about got it covered, Miss Pamela Van Valen Brownlee. Over there on the next to center is another teacher. He teaches autistic kids. He could help me, it seems like, Mr. Greg Brayshaw.
We hail out of the Washington-Idaho border part of the world, but pretty far up, about an hour and a half from Canada. And my husband here flies down and teaches at UCLA and Loyola Marymount in the graduate film departments there. And so we say that he teaches last grade, Mr. Scott Brownlee. And then a man who needs no introduction.
Okay, ready? One, two.
No, I'm kidding.
That's the guy who just, does these kind of gigs just to pay for his banjo habit. This is Mr. Frank Peretti. Hey, we're going to do one for you called Miracles. I heard somebody talking about that earlier today, and this is our answer to that.
Yeah, we had a couple miracles today ourselves.
Hey, everybody. There's a bully out here stomping around. He says he'll fight anybody. He's bragging all over town. With one stone in a sling, David knocked him down. Miracles, they happen every day. The air you breathe, the food you eat, the price for sin you don't have to pay. So choose for you and yours whom to serve and don't delay.
Tweet, tweet. Tweet, tweet. Tweet, tweet. Tweet, tweet. Tweet, tweet. Tweet, tweet.
Prophet school was cramped. To build a new one, they cut some trees. A borrowed axe fell in the water. Elisha, get it out, please. It floated to the surface. Yes, God's the king of the sea.
Miracles,
they happen every day. For sin you don't have to pay. So choose for you and yours whom to serve and don't delay. Trumpets. We're gonna walk for a week around this town,
Jericho.
But don't you dare even speak. The last day they shouted, the walls crumbled right at their feet.
Miracles,
they happen every day.
Miracles, miracles.
you breathe the food you eat, the price for sin you don't have to pay.
Miracles, miracles.
So choose for you and yours whom to serve and don't delay.
Don't delay.
So choose for you and yours whom to serve and don't delay.
Mr. Terry Rudiger.
Lift your voice and sing.
Sing.
Praises to the Lord, Jesus the King of Kings. He's the bright morning star. Your troubles to the Lord. He is faithful to bear the load. Take it to the Lord. His yoke it is easy, his burden is light, he's the door. Yesterday, today, tomorrow, the same. If you knock, the door shall be open for you to step from this world of sin into the loving arms of Jesus. But you must choose to walk on in. You have the choice. We are the sheep of his fold. Lift your voice and sing.
Sing.
Praises to the Lord. Jesus, the King of Kings. He's the bright morning star. Lift holy hands, praise Him wherever you are. Lift your holy hands, praise Him wherever you are.
Greg Brayshaw. Frank, as you all know, is a writer, and he penned this next song. And Pammy has on a necklace here of the Open Tomb, which, no crass commercialism here, but they are available for sale out in the lobby. And no crass commercialism, but our CDs are available for sale out in the lobby. And if you don't like our CDs, we have t-shirts. But the Open Tomb is just one representation of the battle that we're all in and the salvation that we all enjoy.
Whoa. This is our battle cry song. and die. That was the end of the story. Not like Jonathan knew that he could climb up where the Philistine garrison stood. Conquer the enemy, two against all. He put it in the hands of the Lord.
He had no faith in the arrow and bow, in the galloping horse or the clashing sword. Victory lay in the hands of the Lord on the soldier's road to glory. Sword. Victory lay in the hands of the Lord on the soldier's road to glory. Ah, Sword. Victory lies in the hands of the Lord on the soldier's road to glory. Have no faith in the arrow and bow, in the galloping horse or the clashing sword. Victory lies in the hands of the Lord on the soldier's road to glory. Soldier's road to glory. Soldier's road to glory. Soldier's road to glory.
Jesus, oh, it low at thy feet. Oh, look down in love upon me. Let me see thy face so sweet. Give me, Lord, the mind of
going to take you out of here tonight with a short little train ride. Here we go.
Talk about suffering here below, and let's keep a following Jesus. Talk about suffering here below, and let's keep a loving Jesus. Gospel train is coming. Now don't you want to go?
Yonder. Looks like there's some little animal on the tracks.
Oh, it's a little birdie.
That was just a woodpecker. Yeah, we're getting a little bit closer. I don't think that's a little bird. It's a little bit bigger than a bird. Looks like maybe a hound puppy.
Oh.
We're getting closer to that thing, and it looks more like it might be a like a pig. Yeah, you know, that isn't a pig either. We're getting pretty close, and it's a lot bigger than a pig. Maybe a cow? Those ears are too long to be a cow. Let's say we add some coal to this thing and get her going.
Thanks a lot. God bless y'all.
This has been The Covering, presented by Frank Peretti and Northern Cross. To receive a free catalog of all of our Bible teaching books and tapes, information on upcoming Bible conferences in your area, or details of our missionary outreach, call 800-977-2177 24 hours a day or on the web at compass.org.